Alaska, our northern giant, rich in scenic wonders and natural resources, with one of the nation's fastest growing populations. And serving this rapidly awakening giant, whether beneath the northern lights or under the midnight sun, is the state's sole public institution of higher education, the University of Alaska. A land-grant college, its main center on a hill overlooking Fairbanks, the U of A is a statewide system of education with what surely must be the largest campus in the world. The life of a student at the University of Alaska is something very special. It's full of unusual opportunities both for study and for recreation. For instance, the opportunity to take part in a local midwinter's dog sled race. Life can be as different as Alaska itself differs from its sister state. Still, those fundamentals of a good college education are found here. The essentials are unchanged.
Essentially, what Weber is going to do is to take on Karl Marx. For with Marx, you recall, all culture and man's consciousness of that culture was determined by his economic order. And this is, of course, an economic determinant. The nature, that is, of man. Man's relationship with the means of production is what determines his reality. Weber disagreed very, very much.
My major's philosophy and also English. There's two people here in philosophy, and they're exceptional, and I think they're here because of what Alaska has to offer. The state is a place where people can go out and still build their own log cabin and live in the style they want to live, and people are more relaxed, and they're definitely more friendly. There's so much more campus life.
Long winter nights are full of fun and fellowship, and these too are basic essentials.
Remember, please, that this is a place to learn.
The academic year begins with convocation ceremonies in the Patty Gin. University President Dr. William R. Wood welcoming all new students.
I see so many people these days who are so somber, and they're only 18, 20 years old, maybe 21. And they look as if the burdens of the entire world were on their shoulders. You all know how to laugh. I hope that you will exercise this right to laughter. Live with a bit of gusto, if you please. Because this year of your life will never return. I hope that you will make the very most of it. That you will have laughter as well as learning. And remember, too, that your homes are very empty places without you. And if you have not as yet sent that postal card or letter home, I hope that before you go to sleep this evening, that you will. And I hope also that you feel free at any time to drop by my office, come to the house and talk with Mrs. Wood or with me. We have children, too, and they're gone, and our house is empty.
And they do drop by from time to time at the president's home. A lifelong educator with many academic honors, Dr. Wood and his wife came here from Nevada to assume the presidency of the University of Alaska in 1960.
Mm-hmm.
basketball is a major sport here, so too swimming, thanks to a magnificent pool. And over the years, top national honors have gone to the university's ROTC rifle team, which perhaps is not too surprising in this state of outdoorsmen. Winter sports also are popular. The cross-country ski team getting ready for a racing season that will take them as far away as Norway. Since its founding in 1917, the University of Alaska has expanded and grown by leaps and bounds. Today, it offers some 19 undergraduate and graduate degrees, and the building program has been most impressive, with a new gymnasium and swimming pool, and the finest teaching theater on the West Coast. But there have been more important developments than buildings.
I hear more frequently than I care to that all we've done in the last 10 years is build buildings at the University of Alaska. We have built a lot of buildings. The spectacular thing that's happened in the last 10 years has been the quality of the personnel that have been attracted to the University of Alaska. It's something of a phenomenon, really.
I went to Phoenix College for one summer. I went to Kansas for a year. I went to Hawaii for 2 years. Then he decided to come here. Students here have really excellent professors, I think, because people come here because they want to be here. And people here really like it. And the professors, where a department might be really, really small, it can be really, really excellent.
I find that there's not enough competition in any one field that allows you to be pushed out of the program. You're able to do mostly just what you want to do.
The library is quite a facility.
I think it's really fantastic, and it's because it's open stacks. You can get to what you want. You can see what's there. Well, I expected the university to keep up with what's happening in most all fields, and they've been doing a pretty good job.
The International Hydrological Decade and also the Commission on Snow and Ice has adopted a series of field sites on glaciers extending from the South Pole in Antarctica up to McCall Glacier in the extreme northern end of this. And also the other so-called chain of glaciers is on approximately the same latitude surrounding the Arctic Ocean. And so the McCall Glacier is quite uniquely situated.
Graduate student Sam Corbin explains a research project conducted every summer in the Brooks Range, a scant 50 miles south of the Arctic Ocean. The University of Alaska is uniquely situated for conducting Arctic and subarctic research, both on land and at sea. In fact, the whole Alaskan environment can serve the student as a classroom. An automatic station at the 8,000-foot level gathers meteorological data of importance to these glaciologists from the university's Geophysical Institute.
It's basic research, but it's also quite important in assessing the water supply. And we want to find out if the glacier is holding its own or if it's melting away or increasing. And it appears that this year it's pretty much held its own, but last year, 69, it has lost a little. A negative budget, as we would say.
Northwest of the McCall Glacier, some 130 miles across Alaska's north slope, is Prudhoe Bay, with Atlantic Richfield's new headquarters in this fabulously rich oil province of Alaska. Discovery of oil and gas at Prudhoe and elsewhere along the slope has triggered much new research, from the migratory habits of caribou to how to bury a hot pipeline in permafrost. Protection of the Arctic's fragile environment has offered a serious challenge to the oil industry and many rare opportunities to the student of ecology. One of ARCO's summer employees is U of A undergraduate Dean Stritt.
I'm a senior at the university, enrolled in electrical engineering. I'm from Anchorage, and I work for the Anchorage Shield Company here in North Slope. this summer. Once every week or so, we go out to locations where they set thermistors down in the ground to measure the temperature to determine the depth of permafrost. They want to determine how far down they'd have to drive piling in order to get a solid foundation for the bridge. It's also going to be used for pipes coming across the river. That way they don't have to build a separate pipe deal for it. It showed me a real nice time up there. I really enjoyed it.
Down below, the Naval Arctic Research Laboratory at Barrow, operated by the University of Alaska.
Here at Barrow, we are trying to determine what various environmental factors, both natural and man-made, influence the production of plants, sedges, and grasses on the tundra. Several different levels of oil spill were placed on control plots, and the ability of the grasses and sedges to grow and produce in these plots were compared with natural areas which were undisturbed. Was an estimation that about 300 barrels per acre it will still allow normal growth of certain species of grass and sedge.
Dave Norton studies Arctic slope bird life, a sandpiper and her nest. Dave, a graduate student at the university's Institute of Arctic Biology, is working toward his PhD. Near an oil pipeline construction camp, we find Professor Herb Alexander of the university's Department of Anthropology.
The University of Alaska has a section that extends from around Fairbanks all the way up to Prudhoe Bay in order to protect archaeological sites from destruction by any of the activities of the Trans-Alaska pipeline system. This particular site represents a moss house. My guess is it's about 70 to 80 years old. This site, we called it the Putu site in honor of the crew member who found it. That is his native name. He's a native from Anchorage. As it turns out, he found a great number of our sites. We've got spear points that just from the type alone we can tell were used about 4,000 and 7,000 years ago.
Most of the work is being done by students, and it's a good learning process for them. The pipeline work will produce something like 5 master's theses and 1 PhD dissertation by the students. There's a good spin-off from all of this work.
1,000 miles and more to the southeast, the university's research vessel pushes into Glacier Bay, scientist David Burrell and others on board. With a coastline greater than that of the entire continental United States, marine science in Alaska is heavily stressed.
I am on the Acona as principal investigator on this atomic energy contract with the Institute of Marine Science, and we're particularly interested here with the distribution of metals as they occur in the Alaskan environment. It's an important part of the total U.S. investigation effort on trace metals as they occur on the coastal environment. I have working with me one technician for this particular cruise. It's a fairly short cruise. We also have a Dr. Naidu here. He's come over this year from India. This is his first cruise in Southeast Alaska. He's starting a general survey of sediments, inshore sediments, covering a fairly large part of Southeast Alaska. And of course, the samples that he's collecting here in Glacier Bay are an important part of this general survey. And of course, this is a unique environment in America and involves certain conditions which you don't have anywhere else in America. It's a very unpolluted environment. It's a unique setup, and we have glaciers and particular sorts of morphological features along the coast which we don't have anywhere else.
Where but at the University of Alaska can you study muskox management and how to utilize kivia, the animal's wool?
It seems rather clear that we are a leading center of research on the Arctic environment and the subarctic environment. I doubt that there is really any rival in America for this, although many institutions are growing more interested in Arctic research, we have the advantage of being located in the environment.
Summer is a time for academic and scientific conferences on the main campus, one of the most significant being a symposium on the Bering Sea.
The dream of commerce among the peoples of the North Pacific has been with us for nearly 2.5 centuries. And now I think that our dream has taken on a new dimension, and we look forward to the 21st century as a century of the Pacific. We think that perhaps we have here the place where the twain shall meet, the East and the West shall come together. Unless we know the total environment with which we are dealing, this dream is not apt to be realized. And I think it is vastly more complicated here than in the Antarctic area because of people. The peoples that have been here for thousands of years, they are a part of the total environment, and they too must be understood. So I am looking forward to discussion of our people problems as well as very important scientific problems at this remarkable gathering of talent. We are honored by your presence, and we look forward to a very stimulating week. Welcome to the University of Alaska and to the state of Alaska and to the entire tremendous region of the Bering Sea area.
Attending this symposium are over 100 scientists representing Canada, the United States, Japan, and Russia. Dr. Alexei Treshnikov from Leningrad is one of the world's foremost authorities on the Arctic Ocean. This, by the way, is his first visit to Alaska, where the Tsar of Imperial Russia once ruled.
Greetings and best wishes from the Arctic and Antarctic Research Institute in a faraway city of Leningrad. Thank you.
One time, the institution, this would have been back in territorial days, was quite small, was quite unknown, and of course quite isolated because transportation wasn't as good in those days. As a result, the University of Alaska drew perhaps more students from outside of Alaska, for whatever reason one doesn't know, than it did from within Alaska. And that change is rather dramatic now. We're attracting students from Alaska in very large numbers. We have students this year on campus from 49 of the 50 states, plus the Canal Zone, I believe, and the District of Columbia, from 22 or 23 foreign countries. But 75 to 80% of all of our students on the main campus come from the state of Alaska. Now, if you take the system as a whole, and all the community colleges and the regional centers, then I suppose it would be well up above 90% that we would be getting from the state.
The Equinox Marathon, 26 miles, 385 yards. Alaskans take their jogging seriously. Some run the entire distance, others hike, including whole families. And they come from all over the state to compete in this university-sponsored event that occurs every fall. Alaska's future depends largely upon such active individuals as these, many of them students at the U of A. Here comes the winner, Chris Haynes, in just under 3 hours.
We become meaningful to people to the extent that we bring into their own community some direct service of some type.
So that the college student becomes well-rounded. The other programs presented in the Khyber Inn are bringing politicians in to base their views on the University of Alaska.
And maybe that we recruit their children to come to the main campus or one of the regional branches. Or it may be that we establish a community college for academic or for vocational, technical, non-academic instruction right in their own communities. It may be that we simply are carrying on some sort of a research project there. Or it may be that we're some community development public service type of activity. Maybe a mining extension short course, maybe an agricultural extension program, home economics extension, fisheries extension, or helping with an educational project to improve the quality of teaching in the local schools, where we are really attempting to provide some service to the people in their own community to make that community a little more desirable place, perhaps, in which to live the good life.
Anchorage Community College, while the largest, is but one of many. There's the Juno Douglas Community College, one in Ketchikan, another in Kodiak, and six more either active or in the planning stage. Also, two regional centers in South Central and in Southeastern Alaska offering degree programs. And the university is deeply involved in improving the life of Alaska's original citizens, the Eskimos, Indians, and Aleuts. It's involved in a most important educational program, Head Start, as we hear from Pat Sowell, director of the summer training program through Upward Bound.
All Head Start teachers during the summer are involved in an 8-week intensive training program in early childhood education. This summer, they are having this training at Anchorage Community College. Right now, there are 15 teachers undergoing training, and 4 weeks ago, there were another 15 who took part in this practicum training. They're from all over rural Alaska. They're from 38 villages, from Point Barrow to far southeast. They represent all the native cultures of Alaska. Head Start proposes to, and does, in my estimation, provide a comprehensive early childhood education program. This consists of 5 main components: nutrition, the educational program, parent involvement, which is a very important aspect because we feel that we must reach the families of children in order to make real changes in their lives, social services, and medical services for children.
Later on, native students bound for college need a little boost, which is provided on the main campus during the summer.
Upward Bound is a way to get the young people from the villages into the academic life to see what it's going to be like, because it's quite a bit different than it would be in the village in the way of the setting here. Your rules and regulations that govern the type of life we have here are much more stringent than in a village environment, and it does take these young people a short period of time to adjust, but they do adjust very well. We are teaching these young people during the summer months for a period of 8 weeks, just the basic theory involved in electronics, with the hope that many of these young people will want to take this up as a profession, which they can practice in Alaska, being that in Alaska we have great need to keep our young people here and to train them for the jobs that will be available here in Alaska. We have found that a percentage of these young people that come here in the summer do enroll after they finish their high school training. And it has been well known that people that are used to the Alaskan environment and can be trained in a profession within this state live here and produce in this state to the benefit of everyone. This is our main purpose, and if we have to change with the times, we do so.
Once enrolled, there are special orientation services, SOS.
When I first got here, man, I was just lost. I didn't know where to go, and so I asked the information desk up there where was SOS, and he pointed out, and everything was ready for me, no problem.
Students who come up usually don't know anybody, and here in the office, they can come in, and then they meet other students, and I think it's really great.
This year, at the beginning of the semester, I helped with the SOS program. I think it's really a great program. I really think it's worth it. Because, like, when I first started college, I came here, I didn't know a single person. I didn't know who to go to, what to do. And they didn't have anything like this, you know, where you could feel at ease, you could feel you around, you know, somebody that could really, truly help you. I mean, I guess you could really go and try to, but when I first came, I was really shy. But something like this, it's a central place, and all the Native kids hang out here. And if they have any kind of problem, they come here and they feel at ease, you know. They know they can talk to somebody.
Audrey Ambrose, first runner-up in the National Congress of American Indians Queen pageant, a student and SOS counselor. Barbecue for freshmen at the president's home, typical of the informal, friendly spirit that pervades this university campus, where people truly care about their neighbors. University's northernmost FM station. Students beaming quality programs to the Fairbanks area, such as this orchestra concert. Educational television, with the most modern equipment and studio facilities, will soon be in full swing at the university. How's this for contrast? A student folk fest, part of Winter Carnival. Along with dog races and broom hockey. These students will graduate into a world full of new blessings and old curses. New freedom for many, new tyranny for others. Saving and prolonging life as never before, and destroying life as never before. A world full of great promise, but grave danger. The best of times and the worst of times. But at the University of Alaska, they will have received a unique preparation. For here, along with good teachers and modern facilities, they will have learned from the eternal, unaltered wonders of this state, the great land. Indeed, Alaska is our campus.